Well, good afternoon, everybody. It goes without saying that these are not ordinary times, and as a consequence, this will not be an ordinary budget presentation. I come up to you today with no notes and just four simple slides, slides that lay out where we are and where I believe we are going. But first, I want to talk about where we were. We were regaling folks about our economic growth and the incredible economic vibrancy and economic output that the state was enjoying. $3.1 trillion year economy. We were talking about record low unemployment. We were talking about our record reserves, and we were debating how to balance a record amount of surplus. Of course, that was January. A few weeks after that budget, we started to work with the federal government on repatriation flights coming over from mainland China, six flights related to this coronavirus. We clearly, at the time, had an expectation that this was serious, but none of us had a sense of how serious. The focus appropriate at the time was public health. But as you can see from this slide, not only was the state of California impacted by what was to come, but the entire nation and, of course, the world's economy. You can just see here in this chart the U.S. recession that's been induced because of COVID-19. We enter into this moment in a much better place than we have previously entered into any recessionary moment. And I say that soberly, not naively, and I don't say that triumphantly. We are going to be dealing with challenges that we haven't faced in some time. But it is important to note, when we talked in terms of the surplus that we were debating last year, that operating surplus was in the range of $21.5 billion. That was last year's operating surplus that we were responsible for balancing. We paid down debt in the final $4.5 billion in debt from that wall of debt, the infamous wall of debt here in the state of California, that at the time it totaled $34.7 billion. The final payment was done last year, $4.5 billion, completely eliminating that debt. We were thoughtful, perhaps more so than even the last decade and a half, of using those surplus dollars very prudently, even more so than in prior years, where 88% of those one-time surplus dollars went to pay down one-time obligations or to invest in just one fiscal year's investment, meaning we tried to reduce the amount of ongoing expenditure substantially, thus the 12% reflected in this slide of new ongoing commitments. In budget terms, that is a fiscally conservative approach. That allowed us to increase our reserves to a record $16.2 billion. That was just one of a number of reserve accounts in the state. And I'll talk about not only that reserve account, but talk about a number of other accounts where we're able to put aside money, not just in that rainy day fund for a rainy day, but social safety net fund that we had set aside, some $524 million that was set aside in our budget under Prop 98 provisions for our public education system, including some economic uncertainty dollars that were set aside. Long-winded way of saying this. We weren't just asserting fiscal discipline, we were proving it, so much so that our bond rating increased twice last year and was increased to the highest level in over two decades. We're entering into this time of uncertainty in much better place than we entered into it in, for example, 2003, or for that matter, 2009, or in more contemporary terms, 2011. And we are committed, despite the headwinds of a $54.3 billion budget shortfall that we are entrusted to balance in the current fiscal year and into the next budget year. And those core values, those core principles, I think are well reflected in the slide you see next to me. Public education, public health, public safety, and always an eye on people that have been hit hardest by COVID-19. I am not naive by any stretch of the imagination. While as painful as the state's budget may be, personal budgets for so many of you watching are even more devastating. You've exhausted your savings. Your credit has been completely destroyed. You are desperate to get a sense of not only your fate, but our collective future. Some 4.6 million of you have filed for unemployment claims just since March 12th. We are at a time that's simply unprecedented. And when I mean unprecedented, we talk in terms of that Great Recession. That Great Recession, we had unemployment that peaked at 12.3% in the third quarter in 2010. Some 2.2 million people were out of work. I'll go back to what I just said. 4.6 million Californians just since March 12th have filed for unemployment insurance claims or assistance under our PUA program. 2.2, the peak in 2010. Now 4.6 million filing claims so far just since March. We are projecting in our documents we're putting out today in our May revise of that January budget that unemployment will peak north of 24.5%. One could argue we're already there. We are projecting, though, that as a peak. The budget year, we are projecting that we will come in roughly at about an 18% unemployment number. Economic consequences of COVID-19 are not only being felt statistically, but they haven't been felt like this since the Great Depression. This translates very differently to the folks watching that are trying simply to pay the bills, to keep their lights on, to be able to figure out some semblance of optimism about their capacity to get back to work and once again provide for their family and their future. The budget we put out today is $133.9 billion general fund, some $203.3 billion overall budget. The general fund reflects a 9.4% decrease from the Budget Act of 2019. The overall budget, about a 5.4% decrease from the 2019 Budget Act. It's important to note that the revenue decline, the 22.3% revenue decline that I referenced just a moment ago, that comes from three major categories: personal income tax, corporate tax, and sales tax. Not surprisingly, our sales tax revenue projections are taking the biggest hit. Consumers, obviously, not able to make the kind of purchases they once were, only essential. People, obviously, tightening their belt. As a consequence, our revenue projections in terms of decline in sales tax revenue is 27.2%. We're projecting a personal income tax, the PIT, as it's referred to in budget language, to decline by 25.5%, and corporate tax by 22.7%. But all told, in those three main categories, a revenue decline of over 22.3%. And so we start there. That's the baseline. No longer a projected surplus north of $6 billion, but now a projected deficit for the current fiscal year and the budget year that we are announcing and advancing here today of $54.3 billion. Not only do we come in more fiscal, with more fiscal health than we have in the past into this recession with more ample reserves and more capacity for deferrals, the ability to borrow where it's appropriate under these circumstances. But also, we come in with a substantially larger general fund than we have seen in the past. Certainly will be a multi-year opportunity and effort. And I say that because I want to begin there. We are not arguing to solve a $54.3 billion shortfall overnight. We are looking not only at the current fiscal year and next year's budget year, but we're looking at a multi-year strategy to work through this budget deficit. Let's start with the reserves. $16.2 billion of reserves. We are calling to pull down some $7.8 billion in year one from the $16.2 billion of reserves. In year two, we want to bring down an additional $5.4 billion. In year three, $2.9 billion. So we are committing in the documents we're putting out here today to use all of the $16.2 billion in the rainy day reserve, but do it over a three-year period. Because no matter what we do this year, it won't be enough to address the shortfall next year. And we have to be mindful of our responsibility to balance the budget every year, but do so strategically. Remember, no printing press here in the state of California. We are constitutionally obliged to pass a balanced budget. You don't get to obfuscate, you don't get to mediate, you don't get to deviate from that foundational principle. It's a responsibility to submit and to approve a balanced budget. And that is our requirement through the next number of weeks. Has to be done by July 1st of this year. But again, we're looking at a multi-year strategy, and that strategy will include pulling down that rainy day reserve in a sequential way, $7.8, $5.4, $2.9 billion. I mentioned just a moment ago that the rainy day reserve is one of a number of reserve accounts in the state of California. The other reserve account was created a few years ago. That reserve account has $900 million in it. We proposed to the legislature that we use $450 million in this budget year and an additional $450 billion in the subsequent budget year. So, like the rainy day reserve, we draw it down over 3 years. The safety net reserve, we draw down over 2 years. So there you have 7.8 rainy day reserve, $450 million in the safety net reserve. Finally, there was a reserve that was little noticed, but certainly hotly debated, that was probably never even imagined that we'd ever see triggered in our lifetime under the Prop 98 guarantee. And that's the guarantee that supports our K-14 education system. That reserve went into effect a couple years ago. We started putting money in the reserve. Last year, we had $524 million in that reserve. And thankfully, we're going to pull all $524 million of that surplus in to pay down this deficit and help support our education system this year. So you have those three reserve accounts, roughly all totaling $8.8 billion. The CARES Act will provide us an additional 15% of relief in terms of ultimately balancing our budget. So 16% relief from reserves, 15% relief from the CARES Act. In January, I stood up here and I promoted a number of important programs, things that I think overwhelmingly were supported and certainly appeared once again to be embraced by the legislature, focus on expanding our preschool for all programs and investment and further expanding health care to those that are currently without coverage. Series of specific proposals that we made in January. The overwhelming majority of those proposals, we are now pulling back. Those are enhancements to the baseline budget. The vast majority, not all, but the vast majority we're pulling back. That represents an equivalent 15% of the solution. Reserves, 18%, federal government, 15%. The pulling back of these new programs that we were hoping to invest in January provides us an additional 15%. There are three additional categories now that ultimately get us to a balanced budget. The number one area of consternation that just a year and a half or so ago that I highlighted was some of the borrowing from special funds and some of the deferral. 26% of our solutions would come into this category of cuts, but cuts with a caveat. And I want to make this crystal clear. We have been making it crystal clear over the course of the last many, many weeks. And that is, these are cuts that can be triggered and eliminated with a stroke of a pen. President of the United States, with a stroke of a pen, could provide support for Speaker Pelosi's new HEROES Act, and these cuts would be eliminated. These cuts would be triggered And the language in our budget directly triggers the elimination of these cuts. It's in the control section of the Budget Act. Reason I use that in technical terms is I want you to know that's not rhetorical. We are quite literally writing it in to the Budget Act in the controlling section that if the federal government does what it must do under the circumstances to help states, large and small, all across this nation, that these cuts would go away. But the values, nonetheless, we are holding onto, I think and hope will. And I'm going to get to those in a minute as proof points that that also is not just rhetorical flair. So 26% are in the category where the federal government provides the support and relief for states, cities, and counties that those cuts will not go into effect. The final point is about an 8% solution on net operating losses and tax credits that we want to tighten up. That's on the revenue side, roughly $4.5 billion of the total solution. So you add all those numbers up, you get to 100%. You add all those numbers up, what those percentages reflect in budget dollars, that's your $54.3 billion of scaffolding and architecture around this budget. But let me go back. We're going to use some $4.4 billion from the CARES Act to allow for real discretion in real time and put that money, rather than in the general fund, we're going to put it into public education, $4.4 billion, to address the issue of learning loss, to address the socio-emotional challenges that our kids are facing, the trauma and stress their families are facing because of not only lost school time, challenges with distance learning, but the anxiety induced this moment, to help with summer school and to help with the flexibility that the districts are going to need to consider on their own, on a district-by-district basis, what they feel is best for them to address the learning loss. And that includes possibly extending the school year, bringing that school year later into the summer and the like. But this will be discretionary money to substantively address some of the short-term anxiety. That's $4.4 billion. Additionally, we had made commitments, on top of this, I mentioned those commitments, around paying down long-term pension obligations, our PERS and our STERS system. We're going to use one of those payments that was scheduled to pay down these pension obligations, but under the circumstances, the immediate needs, I think, require this of all of us. We're going to use $2.3 billion that was scheduled to be invested for over a 30-year period to pay down pensions to address the immediacy of the crisis in our public education system. So $4.4 and another $2.3 billion. I mentioned net operating losses, I mentioned tax credits, about $1.8 billion of that $4.5 billion revenue that would be generated would go into that 98 account, also reducing the stress. There's an additional $1.6 billion that comes independent of the state contribution in terms of the CARES Act that goes directly to K through 14. That money, $1.6 billion, obviously also goes to reduce the size of that $19 billion shortfall. You start adding this up, now we're north of $10 billion, $10.1 billion in terms of quicker solutions. Two other things we are committing to do. The deferrals also are in this category, which we believe can help obviate some of the stress related to this system. There are reserves that exist also within the school districts. And there's this very important point. We are committing 1.5% of our general fund. And I know this can be very technical, and I'm going to lose 90% of the people, 99% of you watching at home. We have something called the maintenance factor. There's a lot of complexities around how Proposition 98 was advanced to protect public education funding. And we are oblivious to those concerns. And as a consequence, we are committing as a recommendation to the legislature, all of this as a recommendation to the legislature. We are committing to taking 1.5% of the general fund, averaging about $2 billion a year, going up to $4.6 billion a year, to do a supplemental payment under Prop 98. so that the cuts, and by the way, the $19.1 billion annualizes at about $13 billion. If we're going to protect people, protect the PUA program, protect the unemployment insurance program, protect the CalWORKs program, protect the ability to do more on EITC. And so we want to advance those in a very public way and also remind people we're not going to touch the CalGrant program either. And I want folks to know that none of us in state government will be immune from tightening our belts and committing to help the cause and help support those most in need. And so we're asking across the board for 10% contribution in wages. We'll be negotiating and bargaining with each bargaining unit in the state of California. I know this is the last thing that our partners want to hear, but unfortunately, we're in a position where it's required of all of us, and by the way, including me and including my entire staff. We're looking for additional 5% efficiencies in sectors of government across the board. One thing about this pandemic is that it's opened our eyes to possibilities that we may never have seen even 3 or 4 months ago. We talk about work that many of you are doing from home and the telework, how the boomers generation is now experiencing the Zoomer generation, how we are engaging differently than we ever have, conducting business, exchanging commerce, differently than we ever have in the past. Government is operating accordingly, and we will get through it stronger, more nimble, more capable, more resilient than ever. We are not in a permanent state. We are in a state of constant reimagination. And I couldn't be more proud to be governor of a state that prides itself on reinventing itself and reimagining the future. Not just reimagining the future, manifesting a brighter future. One where we're not just growing, but one where we're growing together. And in that spirit of growth and inclusion and health, we submit this budget, and we do so, final words, with a recognition that the enormity of task at hand cannot just be borne by a state. The federal government has a moral and ethical and economic obligation to help support the states. After all, what is the point of government if not to protect people, their safety, and the well-being of citizens? This is an opportunity to make real our purpose and advance our values. It is not just the state of California and its governor that is making an announcement along these lines. It's governors all across this country. The federal government, we need you. These cuts can be negated. They can be dismissed. With your support, this is your moment. I want to thank again the incredible leadership of Nancy Pelosi, and I encourage my Republican friends, those on the other aisle in the Senate, to help support the states, help support the cities, help support counties, help support America and Americans. The HERO Act is the best approach. Everything is negotiable. I'm not naive about that, but the opportunity to move forward and to make real the values at a federal level will help us make real and visible the values here at a state and local level. You want to protect firefighters? Support that effort. You want to protect our police officers and sheriffs? Protect them by supporting that effort. You want to protect our nurses and doctors? Protect them by supporting those efforts at the federal level. You want to protect our kids and our teachers. Our teachers, let's support what Nancy Pelosi is doing. Let's support that federal appropriation. And if we do, that will soften the blow and give us the pathway to get back on our feet much quicker and help grow and once again support the economy as we have supported the recovery of this nation more than any other state over the last decade.